Ephesus head. I know it's hard to take, but her mind has been made up. She didn't want your virginity.
That would be, because you know, because men talk about things like that in a really stupid way. I mean, I don't want to have to lower the tone here by talking about wanking, but I'm going to, because it's essential. People like it, reviewers don't, but people like it. Because it is a confusing time for a guy. The reason I talk about it, I don't talk about it for the men. I talk about it for the ladies, because I think the ladies need to look, because when men are sort of starting out in going doing stuff like that, now ladies, we don't get any attention or any help, because ladies, you're getting all that because you're going through your period. I can't help it, that's how I say it. I'm a man, I can't say it in that context. I can say long period of time, but I guess she's on her period. Because, and don't get me wrong, ladies, I'm not trying to make out that having a period is anywhere near as much fun as having a wank. But, never had one, I wouldn't know. But at the end of the day, right, you know, at least when you go for your period, girls, at least you get a bit of help. At least you get a bit of support. There's that time when you're a young girl and you run down the stairs, I'm hemorrhaging! No, darling, come here. It's okay. You know, I could, when I was 11 years old, I couldn't walk out of my room and go, Dad, what the fuck is this? It's been like it for hours! Fuck off! Couldn't do that. But when you finally figure it out, it's a lot of fun, isn't it? What's your name, sir?
Duncan,
how are you? How are you now, Duncan?
I'm 31.
You're 31. So wanking is meaningless to you now, Duncan. You're at the same stage. It means nothing to you anymore. It's just a basic function. It's just there. That's all it's for, isn't it, now? Do you remember how old you were, Duncan, when you had your first one? You don't. I mean, a lot of guys don't. It's a very delirious time. But I mean, the great thing about having your first one is you don't. And I think all the men would agree with me on this one. You don't need pornography and filth or erotica. You've got your mum's Grattan's catalogue. It's great, right? Well, I had Grattan's. Maybe you were Freeman's. Littlewoods. Burton's. Everyone's got a personality, haven't they? Right. So, and you open up the catalogue and you get that tingling. Do you remember that tingling feeling? You don't get it anymore, do you? Oh, God, you're gonna... And it starts sort of going down your legs and going all around here. Like this weird demon's behind you. And it's really scary. There's blood pumping, adrenaline rush, and it's just really sexy. And I want more of this. It's a little bit scary, but God Almighty! And the weird thing is, you're only looking at the lawnmowers. You're thinking, fuck this, yeah. You think it's a bit weird, but why waste it? You're all in the middle. You've got a grass collecting tray on the back side. I'll never get that in the shed. And some men, I mean, this is the thing that troubles a lot of men. Some men never sort of grow out of that sort of, not wanking over lawnmowers, you grow out of that. 23, it's gone, right? But you get out of that frame. Some men spend their lives trying to recapture that feeling and try and get that feeling back, that first sort of feeling, that first rush. And it's not an uncommon thing. I bet every bloke in this room has got at least one mate who takes wanking a little bit too seriously. If you haven't got that mate, then it's you. Right? You've got loads now. They're never in the room, funnily enough. But they do. So I had a mate when I was 19 years old. His name was Terry. He was the king of the over-elaborate wank. I mean, he put so much fucking effort into it, it was ridiculous, right? He'd come in every few days and regale us with the thing he figured out the night before. And he comes up to me. I'm standing outside at college. It was like Monday morning, 8 o'clock. I'm eating like a breakfast baguette, okay? And this is what happens. Terry comes over to me. Rich, why have you wank with? Right? That's how he started the conversation. Not hello, good morning, nothing logical. No, why have you wank with? And I was a bit nonplussed. I'm like, well, I'm right-handed. And he went, right, figured this out last night. Next time you're having a wank, don't use your right hand, use your left hand, because it feels like a woman's doing it. And you're laughing, he's right, I did it, and it's fucking shit. I love it. There's a lady in the front applauding that. It's brilliant. Is that your technique? Is that why it's the worst thing? Come on, Bert, get your coffee out. I don't want to, I mean, you, you're taking that in good spirit, but I mean, I don't want to sound like I'm having a go, lady, but men get the fucking jip over this. We have a go. And, you know, every bloke, I'm sure, you know, Duncan, I'm sure you've been in this position before. You know, I'm sure that, and if there's young blokes here around, you know, you will do eventually. You'll be with that one woman, and you think, oh, her hair's going down. You think, this is going to be fucking incredible. And she basically thinks she's giving you a blood pressure examination. Gives it away. It's like she's going on a ride in all the towers. Right, so I've got a hold of his cock as tightly as I possibly can. The end is throbbing. He's the same colour as my dog's. Right, now. Blood's coming out the end. I'm going to basically couple this with the soothing rhythmic tones as if I were trying to get the last bit of sauce out of the bottle. And you have to, she looks up at me again. You have to suck tears back into your mouth. Because it's the only liquid leaving you at that moment in time. You enjoying that? Shall I suck it for you? No, no, no. So we do get a bit of stick over it. Yeah, and some women, when I tell that joke about the left-handed wife, some women get really shitty about it. And it's always a particular, you ladies have taken it in really good spirit, and most women do, they realise it's a joke. It's perfectly true, but it's a joke. But basically, you get some women who really don't like that joke, and they're a particular sort of woman. You don't get them anymore, really. They're the sort of women you used to get on Jerry Springer. They basically can't talk to you without giving you out of this fucking business. What's the everything they say has got, some sort of weird condition, jive epilepsy. Motown Parkinson's or something. I was doing that joke once, and I said to this woman at the front, I said the left-handed bank joke, this woman went, excuse me. It's very funny, and it might be true, but at the end of the day, I think you need to realise, okay, that when it's your turn, when it's the bloke's turn to do it for the women, you're not much better at it. And I said, you're right, love. You're absolutely right. I'm not going to disagree with you on that. That's a perfectly valid point. Men are just as bad when it comes to doing it for women. But ladies, there's ladies here. Ladies, let me ask you a question. Do I really have to come out here and tell you what men are crap at in bed? Do I really have to come on this stage every fucking day, even if it was just to be fucking fair, do I have to come out here and tell you the erotic failings of mankind? No, I don't have to do that. I don't do it, girls. Do you know why I don't? It's because you've already fucking told everyone that. Every bastard from here that's in my fucking tomb knows everything. God forbid, Duncan, you've probably been in this position before. When you're in bed with a woman, and you make a mistake. You make a mistake, Duncan. Do you know why you made a mistake, Duncan? It's because you're a human being. You're not a fucking robot, okay? You make a mistake, you might fail to turn up. You might arrive too early. You might try and go into the house through the wrong door. Whatever you do, in the morning you're going to feel vulnerable. You're going to feel insecure. You're going to feel fragile. Because you're a human being. And these will pick up on that. They'll see you and they'll give you that Oscar-winning performance. Don't worry about it. It's not a big deal. It happens to a lot of men. It doesn't bother me, so it shouldn't bother you. Within an hour, Duncan, your mum knows, everybody knows. She's set up a MySpace page at Facebook. She's emailed the Pentagon. She's got the red arrows to spill it out in bed, smoking the fucking sky. You come home from work that day, embarrassed as fuck. You turn on the TV, panorama, there's Michael Burke. Last night, Duncan failed to perform sexually for a woman. We ask the question, is he a fag or what? Fresh new horn out of the reborn.
gonna do a day for with a guy cautious. No one is a nice guy, gonna be a wise guy. Drink a dozen my dice, smoke some crack and get a heart. Let's hide a scene from a $2 skank. Watch one guy, one jar, and give a dead horse a wank. Slag a hobo and run over your friend until I get a lifelong YouTuber.
Ladies, the one thing ladies do that impresses me more than anything is you deal with the male ego. Because that's what you do. We've got couples here, we've got people. You obviously a couple. I've been out with your stalking her and you're very bad at it, sir. You just, are you a couple? Oh, you're taking her hand. Is she numb from the waist down? And she didn't realise you were just holding her leg. And I was fucking getting a free feel up here, she won't drink it. Are you a couple, you two? Sort of. This is. I don't sense a lot of future here. On the basis of that answer, the rest of it. We've got Duncan, it's you with this lady here. No, we've got anyone, we've got fucking four women in there. We've got any couples in here tonight?
Yeah.
Oh, over there at the back, sat at the back, yeah. And you two there on the end, how long have you been together?
7 years.
7 years? Well, she's done you, sir. You're fucked. You're with her, I'm not saying it's a bad thing, but you're with her for the rest of your life, basically. And what she, I've actually did it to you, what happened to you, what happened to me, sir. My girlfriend, very clever, she used to ask me questions. But those special woman questions. Not a regular question like, how are you today? What's for dinner? No, not one of those simple questions that has a straightforward answer. No, one of those special lady questions that requires you to lie your absolute fucking balls off for a good 3 minutes at least, right? And you can't think about the answer. No, it's questions, lie, like that. It's one of the, I was in bed with her, right? And, yeah, we just done it, right? And, yeah. And was in bed, and she about 30 seconds had gone past, so you know, the blood hasn't fully returned to my head yet, right? Okay. And she says, Richard, when we're having sex, do you think of anyone else? I think, yeah, well, you've asked this before, haven't you? But I panicked, but I got the answer right away. No, honestly, I don't think of, why would I want to think of anyone else? Honestly, I think of you the whole time. She went, that's so sweet. Why do you think of me? And I panicked and went, because I want to last longer. Now, I know. Cut that last one. Don't do the laughing. In fact, don't even do it. Never think of another woman while you're having sex with your woman. Do what I do. Fuck up women and think of her. It's a lot easier. But I love, the male ego is a complex thing, because the male ego is geared to making the man adapt himself to the surroundings. The female ego is different. The female ego works to making everything else around him adapt to her. That's the way it generally works. And the male ego is all about, you know, making you be the best, no matter where you are. Right? And I learned this the hard way. In 2002, for a year, I genuinely saw it in Canterbury in Kent, where I live. I worked in a place called Bar 11, which is a gay bar, okay? Now, I was 22 years old, I went to drama school. So I knew gay, I lived in a shared house with a gay guy for several years. So I had no anxiety, no fear, I had no prejudice about homosexuals or homosexual behaviour. But I was 22 years old and I had that fear about gay bars, which every heterosexual man has, and every heterosexual man believes that as soon as you walk into a gay bar, they're all fucking each other. They're all fucking, there's just cocks and arses everywhere. There's bums and balls everywhere. There's women clam jousting. There's fucking, they're all over there like that. And you can't walk in, don't walk into a gay bar, for fuck's sake. Don't walk in there, you'll just be fucked right away. You'll go up to the bar, won't you? You can have a pint of cooking in the mouth, fucking the arsehole, fucking the what would I ever say, so don't do it, right? But I worked at this gay bar for a year, and I was worried because no one chatted me up. In a year, no one chatted me up. How pissed off was I at the end of that fucking day? I started going to work in suspenders and PVC top, going, come on, boys, for God's sake. I went right on my sin, place balls here, fuck all, nothing, right? Not a fucking thing, right? This gay guy called John, who came in there all the time, he said, Richard, I know what you're so worried about. And the reason I was chatting you up is it's obvious you're not gay. Ego kicked in. Right, come to the toilet, John. I'm showing you he's fucking gay. Come in here. I made my point. It wasn't worth it. But, you know, I learned a lot about homophobia as well. So I didn't know a lot about it, right? And some people are homophobic without even realising it. They don't mean to be, they just are, okay? And I was in there one night, and there was this couple came in, you know, late 40s, right? A couple, man and woman. And obviously didn't know it was a gay bar, because you didn't know it's a, you don't know what gay bars are. Nowadays, Gay bars aren't like they were in the 80s when it was like a big pink neon building called the Giant Sausage Munchers Club or something. They were a bit more subtle, they just looked like regular normal bars now. This couple came in, they'd been there for an hour, and I think he'd noticed there was a lot of things his brain couldn't compute happening around him, like a lot of beard on beard action going on, okay? That was just some of the lesbians, right? And he's and so he's feeling probably felt a bit, oh, this is a bit unusual. So he went up to the bar where I was, and he said, "Excuse me, is this a gay bar?" I said, "Well, it's not a gay bar as such, and it's a gay-friendly, is the PC term. You know, anyone can come here and drink, just like any other bar. But we do have a lot of gay clientele. They come and go as they please." And he asked me the weirdest question. He said, "I'm here with my wife. Will we feel uncomfortable at any time?" "Well, not if you use some lubricant, sir. I've got some back here." "What do you think was going to happen? It's 8 o'clock, it's fisting time! Come on, everyone grab it! Oh my God, what do you think was going to happen?" And it's weird the nature of homophobia, because there's one theory about homophobia, that if you're homophobic, if you're a bloke and you're homophobic, it's because you've got suppressed homosexual urges. I'm sure you might have heard this theory. If you're homophobic, it's because you've got gay desires in your body and they're shameful to you. So they manifest in a hatred of gay people. There's lots of evidence to prove that this might be the case. There's even evidence to suggest that Hitler was a homosexual. Which, you know, might sound a bit shocking, but when you think about it, you know, all the leather boots and all this fucking business. Kyle, yes, sure, love, yeah. Swastika looks like an anus. Anyone else? No, forget it. But, you know, there's a recent case, this is brilliant, there's a recent case in America, a guy called Ted Haggard, who was he's the leader of the American Evangelical Church, right? Big fucking church in America. He was the head of the leader of the American Church of Evangelicals. Notoriously homophobic, gets caught by his wife, being shagged in the arse by a 17-year-old Romanian rent boy while smoking crystal meth and wanking over gay porn. Now, I have a lot of respect for this guy, because I think if you're going to do something wrong, fucking do it right. No, wanking over gay porn, not enough. Smoking crystal meth as well? Possibly. 17-year-old rent boy fucking you in the arse. That's the fucking ticket. And he got caught by his wife, and you just know what happened, didn't you? He's there, Eastern European lad, he's got his crystal meth pipe, he's smoking it, he's wanking over gay porn, and you just know that his wife walked in and he went, "This isn't what it looks like."
We follow the Führer. Our blood is purer. We've never been so surer that AIDS is the gay cure. We worship
Adolf, crazy motherfucker called Hitler. His book Mein Kampf, man, that was the shit, yeah.
You gotta be right, then you gotta be white. If you choose to be black, then Nazis attack
your ass. But not like a queer, another man's dick I wouldn't go near.
We're white, we're...
No, there's a lot of Muslim hysteria in the world at the moment, particularly in this country, it's rife. And I think it's, you know, you hear this a lot, but it is genuinely true, you know, that it's only a small percentage of Muslims who are fucking it up for the rest of them. You know, there's 2 million Muslims in this country, and they're not all, you know, they're not all that like that. And I can prove that because I went to, I'm sure you'll remember, about 18 months ago, a guy in Denmark got in trouble when he drew a cartoon of the Prophet Muhammad. I'm sure you all remember that. Big no-no. Mohammed doesn't like cartoons being drawn of him, apparently. And so, around the world, there was a lot of, you know, major incidents. But in this country, well, not in this country, it was in London. There was a protest in London. And I went along to see it, see what the big fuss was. And it was a really nice protest. It was really dignified. It was really peaceful. A lot of honour, a lot of respect. All wearing the Muslim gear, all wearing with their banners, Union Jacks and what have you. And I thought, this is really nice. But there was one bloke there who fucked it all up for everyone. He was a Daily Mail journalist's wet dream, this guy. Because he'd made a banner like everyone else had. I don't think he thought it through, though. See, if he could spot the mistake, you might have even seen this. He had a banner that said, "Behead all those who say Islam is violent." Behead all those, violent. Now, this is what pissed me off. There were thousands of people on this march. I can't believe one of them didn't go, "Imran, for fuck's sake, mate, come over here, Imran." It's a tax counterproductive, okay? You wouldn't do, you know, you wouldn't do this at any other pro. You wouldn't go to a protest with a banner that said, "Stop paedophilia, shoot children." It kind of... "Oh, it's a lie, mate, no one had a banner. Make poverty history, let's nuke Africa." It kind of... It kind of steps on the point there, really. But I mean, what annoys me about this situation, this Muslim hysteria, is it always gets based around the most irrelevant. People are almost pushed into the most irrelevant argument. In this case, it's the veil. That's what we all argue about. The veil. If women didn't have cloths over their faces, 9/11 wouldn't have happened. That's basically it. I mean, I don't get the veil personally. I don't really understand why you want to wear a veil, but if you want to, that's fair enough. You know, I think if God wanted you to wear it, cover your face, he'd have put an extra flap of skin over your nose. Who are we to defy God, quite frankly, right? But, you know, you do get people who are sucked into this Muslim hysteria argument over the veil. And this sort of, they get sucked into this. And I just think, you know, at the end of the day, and there might be people here, there might be good, decent, honest, kind-hearted souls, but you do get into this veil hysteria. And I can change your mind right now by giving you a simple scenario. You're walking down the street late at night, no one else is around. On this side of the street, you've got a little Muslim woman in the full veil. On this side of the street, you've got some 14-year-old council estate imp with his hood up and his baseball cap there, socks tucked into his fucking tracksuit, whatever mini jumpers they are, and he's dribbling and texting because he's forgotten how to fucking think for himself, so he's texting himself there. And what side of the street are you going to walk on? I don't know about you, I'm with the little Muslim bitch over here. I don't give a fuck if she's dressed like a gothic Dalek, that's her. I'm walking with her and I'll tell you why, because at some point that little cunt's going to pull a knife out and when he does, I'm going to kill him. So, you know, you don't need to worry about it. But, you know, going to the other side of the street now, moving on from there, talk about the hoodies, because hoodies are an interesting thing, because, you know, in the old days, you know, they're not a new thing. In the old days, they'd have been called rascals or, you know, ragamuffins and things like that. Then they're just called, you know, hoodies and chaps. And I think instead of sort of giving these kids a badge of honour with an ASBO, which is how they treat these fucking things, we should be trying to think of a solution to how you can stop these. But they're just unfortunate. They're not stupid. They're just unfortunate. And, you know, you've got to talk to these kids in a language they can understand. And a lot of these kids listen to rap music, which I don't know if anyone here is into. And there's a rap collective in the UK I was listening to a little while ago, and they're called the So Solid Crew. Yeah, someone giggling at that already. That's how shit the So Solid Crew are. It's a great thing. If you're into comedy, you don't have to write a joke. You just come on stage and go, So Solid Crew. Good night. And then you walk over. But they released a song in this country. It was called 21 Seconds. It's 6 minutes long. And there's a lot, if you haven't heard of the So Solid Crew, this is how crap the So Solid Crew are. They're a rap group, there's 25 of them, none of them have been shot. How shit do you have to be? There's more to aim at, one of them must have fucking, anyway. But they released this song, 21 Seconds, there's a line at the end of that song, one of the rappers, he goes, tool multiplied by 10 plus 1. Which is 21. Now, there must have been one kid, surely, somewhere. Millions of people bought this record. There must have been one kid who didn't have a fucking clue what 2 times 10 plus 1 was. If he'd have got that in his hand, he'd have been fucked. He didn't have a clue. What's the... I haven't got a clue. But now he can go, I know what this is. I listen to the So Solid Crew, okay? A star off to Oxford, okay? Now, what we need to do is get rid of people like the So Solid Crew. We need a more positive rap group, the So Science Crew, who are a gang of elite, hardcore, Mensa rude boys who rap mathematical equations into garage music, and the kids would remember them, they do better at school, it's staying in their heads. I think it's a good idea, don't you think? It'd be great to come out and go, yo, check this, yo, what's square root 49? Yo, what's square root 49? Yo, what's square root 49? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, that's the square root 49. 7, that's the square root 49. Yo, tell me the Pythagoras theorem. Yo, what's that Pythagoras theorem? Yo, tell me the Pythagoras theorem. It's the sum of the square root of any two sides of a right angle triangle is equal to the square root of the remaining, side. No. Get this enough in rap music anymore, do you? The deep bow at the end. Snoop Dogg comes out and goes, I think not.
Beckham of stand-up comedy. The reason for it's nothing to do with me being good-looking and stylish, obviously, and it's not because I'm any good at football. The reason I'm called the David Beckham of stand-up is because the reason it's okay, sir, I've got my own punchline, so I've come prepared. This is one of the aspects of stand-up you learn. Don't just write the joke and then forget the punchline. Go, fuck it, that feed is brilliant. It doesn't even need a fucking finish. The reason I'm called the David Beckham of stand-up is due to the fact that everyone who's ever met my wife really wants to smack her in the fucking mouth. But I'm it's very impossible. I was doing a gig years ago, I was doing this gig in Manchester, and this guy, I just mentioned this guy, I cropped up in conversation. I said, I've got Tourette's syndrome. He loses his, oh, go on, mate, do it, go on, do it, please, if you're hilarious, go on, please, 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 please. Basically, he just wanted me to have a fucking panic attack for his amusement, right? It's a bit out of order, really. I mean, it's a little bit... You talk about being politically correct. It's a little bit out of order. You wouldn't do that of any other disease, would you? You wouldn't do that of anything else. If I said to the guy, this isn't like TV, you know, I can't hear you, I can't... There's no red button for fucking interactive. This is... I know when you're having a chat during Coronation Street, Liz Patterson just go, would you shut the fuck up? But I will. Oh, brilliant. I can't even remember the joke. It's meaningless now. It's gone. Fuck the joke. Let's just fucking say that. There's a setting you've ever known in Hull. And... Oh, no. Don't be wrong. I've got unfinished business here. I'm not there this time. I've been suffering for 7 years to let this fat ball fuck ruin it all for me. Sorry? Did I have enough of him the first time? I could never get enough of him, madam. The light of the sun bouncing off that head gave me arc eye during the buttery acid. I was put on a welder's mask and a pair of sunglasses. So. I wish every audience could be like you, then I wouldn't have to waste my time writing shit. I saw the funniest news story. I'll talk about this. I saw the funniest news story on Sky News 2 days ago. This was delivered as a piece of bad news, right? You know, they're like doing these stories about how life in prison is so cushy and lovely and wonderful. This was the result. Results of a recent survey have shown that life in British prisons is so good that the prisoners don't even want to try and escape. Good! I don't want some fucking nutter who's raped 12 dogs and he and his family trying to come and play fucking get out. I want him to stay there, for fuck's sake. I want him left. If it stops me getting skinned alive and bugging on the way home, I say, fuck it, give Peter Sutcliffe an Xbox. That'll be good. Wear boots like this, people tend to come up to you and go, your toes go all the way to the end of the moment. And what I tend to say is, yes, but my legs end there. But I walk on stage. Now, I don't know if this is the best or the worst heckle, but I don't think it's ever going to get topped. I walk on stage, first gig ever in Northern Ireland, and I walk on stage as I am now, half man, half magic wand, and I walked on stage, a pyro refill with a haircut, and I walked on stage, but I haven't even said anything, I just got to the mic, and this bloke in the front row goes, excuse me! In that typical sort of Northern Irish accent, so half an epicorn and a rape alarm, basically. And he goes, excuse me! Are you gay? Which, when you get asked that question with that level of aggression, it kind of sort of throw you a bit. And I didn't say yes or no, there's no point. So I just looked at the guy and said, why do you think I'm gay? And this is what he said, because you look like you've got it! Don't act shocked, this fucking really happened. This is true life. I'm on stage in front of people, fucking this happened. Because I look like I've got AIDS and I couldn't. The problem I think I hated about that heckle is I can't do anything about it because it's true. I can't deny it. This is why you laughed when I said it. You went, it does, yeah. I was trying to. It does look like he's got AIDS. I had Bruce Springsteen playing in my head. I couldn't get it out. I didn't know why. I didn't fucking know why. So I'm stumped at this point, and this motherfucker sat there. He's asked me this question. About 10 seconds went by, and he sat there and went, I went, oh, fuck it. So I spat in his mouth, and I feel like... Hey! Thank you, sir. And the pitch didn't wash me hands. Sometimes you come up with a brilliant heckle put down line, but it's not funny at the time. Because I had this guy heckle me, I was doing eating clapper, and there's it. There we go. Is that what you're doing? Is it just swoosh? There we go, we're ready. I have this guy in the front row, and he's one of these guys who just, I mean, you know, you might have experienced these people before, these people who sit at the front and just don't shut the fuck up. You're doing it in a positive way. I mean, this guy, he was there to ruin the night. He was sat in the front, but he was sat in the front just off to the left. This guy's there, and he's just interrupting every little fucking bit, every little bit. And I went up there and I had enough, and I went, excuse me, mate, would you shut the fuck up? And he looked at me and went, no. But when he looked at me, he wasn't looking at me, he was looking off to the side. For a minute I thought, he had one of the, do you remember when you were at school, you had one teacher who had one of those funny fucking eyes that went up and that you never knew which one was which, and they try and bollock you, and then they try and line up with the other eye, circle it the fuck up in the middle of the classroom. But I thought, you can't have two eyes like that, both of them. And I said, why won't you look at me? And he goes, because I'm blind. And I was like, well, is this true? What proper blind? And he was a bloke. I thought he was exaggerating, just having to do it, hand me up. I went, what proper blind? He went, yeah, I can't see a thing. I went, well, if you're blind, what the fuck are you sitting in the front row for, you selfish bastard? There's people with good eyesight at the back, screaming a fucking seat. You're taking up the fucking front. You're supposed to have good fucking hearing. If you were that intelligent, you could have stayed outside the foyer and fucking heard the big kids as well. Save the fucking fiver. Yeah, that's the reaction I fucking got. Fuck him, he's disabled and he's a cunt. That makes us worse in a way. With me, you know, I do look like I'm dying. This is kind of a look, this is a look I've got. People are always worrying I look ill. I'm not. This is just, some people look suave, chiseled, slim, athletic. I'm like the next, size zero, I'm the next one down. I'm terminal, right? That's it. I'm life support machine, I'm chemo sheep, right? People take the piss, so not. I went to Disneyland 2 years ago, shaved me and got in for fuck all. I don't care. Second-hand wheelchair, bollocks front of the queue, put the wigs on, get the little wigs, put them on the dying kids, fuck it, I'm not getting in front, there we go. But there's several other problems with that, and the first problem is this. The other problem, I don't mind being single, for several reasons. I'm not very good in a relationship. Two main reasons. Number one, I'm shit in bed. I know that's a weird thing to announce to a room full of strangers, but it's clear that I am shit in bed. My problem is longevity, in that, well, I don't know what it is, I haven't figured that bit out yet. Last, shortevity. I'm struggling with shortevity at the moment. Fuck longevity. Like, it's quite bad. This is how bad it is. The other day I was having a wank and I came so quickly I apologised to myself after that. Well, I say myself, I mean, everyone else in the swimming pool as well, you know? I mean, all their carers and things like that. Being crap in bed, now... it is an admission that I actually said 10 minutes ago. It shows how much fucking attention you've been paying. He's not a bit slow, he's fucking stopped. He's fucking stationary. Archaeologists on time team will dig this fucker up in a few years time. You've actually reversed man's development, sir. When they dig you up in 5 million years, they'll go, this is how they ended up back in the fucking sea, isn't it? Guys, it's been a pleasure. Take care, good night. Coughlan, ladies and gentlemen!
Fantastic. It's Richard Coughlan! Good evening! Hello! You okay?
No,
you're not. Fantastic. Right, that's one. That's all. So I'm actually in a good mood. 2 weeks ago, I finally got on the property ladder in London. Well, I found a fucking unused greenhouse in an allotment in Clapham. That $1,400 a month, that's not too bad. But I recently found, they say people in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. I've recently worked out it's not a good idea to wank during the day, either. And mop it up with the neighbour's cat. They just really don't... It is nice, but it's good to be back in London, because I did my first... I'll tell you this story. It was about a month ago, I did my first gig in Northern Ireland in a town called Derry. Anyone from Northern Ireland? No, can't be bothered. No, good. There was barely anyone there either. But I don't know if this is the worst or the best heckle I've ever fucking got, but it was. This actually happened. This is a completely true story. I walked on stage, as I am now, half man, half biro refill, basically, and... I haven't even got to the fucking stage, and I walk up to the microphone, bloke at the front goes, excuse me! Right, in that, understated Northern Irish accent. It's like a cross between a leprechaun and a rape alarm, basically. Is the, he goes, excuse me, are you gay? I was a bit, there's no yes or no, you don't need a no right answer. I just looked at him and said, why do you think I'm gay? This is what he said, because you look like you've got AIDS. Yeah, laugh it up. Yeah, fucking. I'm on stage in front of people, and it's the worst heckle for me because it's fucking true. I can't even deny it, right? That's why you laughed when you fucking said, I'm standing there, 10 seconds, absolute silence, and I looked at the guy, and he started going, hey, I thought, fuck you. So I spat in his mouth, and that. That's a heckle put down for you there. It's the next 6 weeks of your life fucking ruined, isn't it, right? But the thing is, the guy had a point. I do look like I'm dying. This is like my sort of thing. You know, there's like size zero. I'm terminal chic. This is like, you know, chemo style, I like to call it. Don't take the day. People take the piss. It's saved me a lot of money. My mates used to take the piss. We went to Disneyland 2 years ago. I shaved my head. I got in for fuck all. It was incredible. But I do just look ill all the time. This is just the look I've always had. And not to say, I'm nothing wrong with me, but that's not to say I'm healthy. I mean, I smoke 18 bajillion cigarettes an hour. Who here smokes a lot? Anyone? There's a few. They're all dead. See, it's just me fucking. Anyone smoke? Give us a cheer. There's a few. I mean, the problem I've got with smoking nowadays is, first thing, the warnings on the packet. I'm not going to moan about the warnings themselves, but they're getting a bit aggressive these days, the warnings. They're getting a little bit angry at you. I bought a packet of cigarettes the other day. It just said, you are a cunt. That's all it said, right? And I turned it over. There was a picture of my mum crying next to a tombstone. I thought. And it's a bullshit thing anyway, the health warning. The only reason, where are the Americans? We've got some in, haven't we? Yeah, over there, yeah. I mean, it's because of you, because you did the thing you always do best. You sued the tobacco companies years ago, and that's what, because you needed someone to tell you that breathing in huge lungfuls of smoke was fucking bad. And this is where common sense kicks in. There's no warning on my toaster saying, when toaster is on, do not insert penis. You know, I don't need these things. Don't fall asleep in the oven. You might have a bad day tomorrow. You know, it's like. But that's why you've got the warnings there, because we live in such a litigious society. You get the warnings, I've got my phone here. It just says, smoking kills, smoking fucking kills. You smoke and you die, smoking kills. Right, but we live in such a sort of, everyone's trying to sue everyone for anything these days. I reckon it's going to go the other way around. Smoking kills, what if it doesn't kill me, right? Let's say tomorrow I go to the doctors, he tells me I've got some disease, it's terminal, I'm going to be dead in 6 weeks, and I would have got it whether I smoked or not. At that point, shouldn't I legally have the right to sue the tobacco company under Trade Descriptions Act for selling me a fucking product that didn't do what it fucking said, right? I want to be the first guy to sue a tobacco company for not getting cancer, right? But this is the thing, and also looking like this, it's hard to pull. It's impossible, really. I can't take a certificate, health certificate, every single time. And if I don't go and a woman shows a bit of interest, I'm a little bit dubious of her. Because I think she just look at me and thinking, he looks like he's got what I've got. Fuck it, let's go for it. You know what I mean? I'm not trusting that, right? You know, and there's several reasons I have these problems with. You know, first of all, I'm shit in bed. That's the first thing I'd like to clear that up now, right? It's not even a joke. It's perfectly. Don't R me. You wouldn't fuck me. No, you wouldn't, would you? No, yeah. Bloke going, you all would. All right, fair enough. Right, but look at these shoes. I can't be too picky. Now, anyway. But no, this is the thing. I'm crappy. My problem is longevity. Well, it's not even longevity. It's shortgevity at this moment. I can't. It's just bang. It's over. Gone. Just fucking gone, 3 seconds over, right? And, you know, and it's just, I tell you how bad it is. The other day I was masturbating, I came so quickly I apologised to myself afterwards. That's and everyone else in the swimming pool, obviously, you know, but the what I had, I mean, I hate it, it's a bit of a negative term, I hate it, premature ejaculation. It's like, you know, there's no bloke in here who's ever had a premature ejaculation. It's enthusiastic, you know, it might be inconvenient for the others who are currently in the room with you at the time, but It's just, and I hate the fact it's always on me. The onus is always on me. It's like, you know, the woman's always like, oh, God, why can't you fucking go slower and last longer? Fuck you, why can't you hurry up? This is like, let's negotiate here. Girls, I ask any woman here, if you could come after 3 seconds, would you try to not fucking do... No, you fucking wouldn't, right? Don't persecute me because I'm more highly evolved. There is, it doesn't... the other problem is I've got a small penis. That's the other problem. It's it works. I mean, it's there. It works. It's nothing to write home about, you know. Not that you would anyway. I mean, you wouldn't... There's a bit of a weird letter to write home, that one, isn't it? Dear Mum, I have a big cock, love Richard. That's just... I mean, you probably would anyway, but fuck it. No, but this is... I do have a small... But I think the world would be better if like, every bloke had a small dick. There'd be several advantages to it. If every bloke had a tiny cock, there'd be several advantages to this system, right? First of all, you'd get rid of those... Most blokes who brag about the size of their cock are liars, right? But every bloke here has got that one mate who just needs no excuse just to whip it out and fucking show you it and dance around an aeroplane. And look at the fucking size of that. My dick's fucking huge. Look at that fucking... Look, I have to use a Pringle tube for a condom. Look at that fucking... It's fucking... Look at that. My dick, when it's fully on, when it's full on, that's on the slide. When it's full, it's 18 inches long and it's 15 inches round. I'm like, yeah, what, so's a baby. I've never seen a woman enjoy having one of them pulled out of her. Women don't give birth, oh, that's fantastic, he's nearly there, Mrs. Johnson. No, fucking push him in, push the fuck up, put a crash helmet on him, for fuck's sake, wrap him. You don't, and you, people worry too much about, I mean, I've got some people, but you can get too carried away. I've got one mate, his name's Terry. He's a lovely bloke, but the problem with Terry is he's what I call a wank connoisseur. He's, you know, if they had wank soirees, he'd be the head guy with the biggest top hat, right? He's an enthusiast of masturbating. He is an onanist king. And the problem with him is he gets far too carried away with it. And whenever you end up being single, I hang around with Terry, he's my single friend, right? And I hang around, and he invents new ways to fucking masturbate and to come up. He invents new things he can come up with. And this is the last one he gave me. He went, Rich, what hand do you wank with? He's, you know, okay, that's how he started the conversation, right? It's like, I'm right-handed. He went, right, next time you're having a wank, don't use your right hand, use your left hand. I was like, why is that? Because it feels like a woman's doing it. I know you're laughing, but he's absolutely right. I did it that night. It was fucking shit. Right? But... Some women clapping at the back there. I like that. Yeah, we're fucking rubbish. We're coming... Is that your technique? That might be why it's not working. I always say, girls, if you feel that's unfair, you can prove me wrong afterwards. I'll be in the toilets away, and as you've already been told, it won't last long, and it's not going to take up too much effort, so we don't have to... Ladies and gentlemen, it's been an absolute pleasure talking to you tonight. It's been wonderful, as always. Thank you very much. Take care. Good night.